I'm Gregory Durr, Howard County Police Chief, and I'm joined by Bill Barnes, Howard County Public School System Superintendent, who will you hear in a few minutes. I want to provide an update into the investigation of October 9th's homicide of McKendrick McKellum. As we announced on Tuesday, we arrested a 17-year-old from Ellicott City and charged him as an adult with first-degree murder. He was arrested at Howard High School, and a loaded gun was recovered from his backpack. He's being held on no bond at the Howard County Detention Center. I'm here to announce now that detectives have arrested the second suspect in this case. He is a 14-year-old male from Severn, and he is also charged as an adult with first-degree murder. He was taken into custody on Wednesday at his high school in Anne Arundel County. His bail review was held this morning, and he's being held without bond at the Howard County Detention Center. Before I get into more on this case, I want to express my condolences to the family of Mr. McKellum. No family should have to experience the loss of a loved one to senseless violence. Our thoughts are with them, and they have been extremely cooperative during this investigation. I want to walk you through the timeline of this case and the investigation. It is still ongoing, and I will not be able to share many details today. But from the moment the victim was discovered on October 12th until right now, our detectives, officers, crime scene technicians, and many others have worked tirelessly to bring justice for the victim of his family. I could not be more proud of the work of our department has done in investigating this case and arresting these suspects. Early on October 12th, an officer located the victim deceased in the driver's seat of his vehicle in a parking lot of an office building in Columbia. The officer had just graduated from our academy last month and was on his third week of field training. His diligence and observance led to this discovery. From there, detectives reviewed hours of surveillance video and determined that the shooting occurred on October 9th around 5 o'clock. There was no cause for shots fired at that time. In the course of the investigation, detectives reviewed many additional hours of surveillance video from the area and used a variety of other investigative techniques to identify these suspects. We believe that the victim picked up both suspects from a residence in Ellicott City and drove to that location in Columbia where he was shot. We believe that the victim and 17-year-old suspect knew each other, but the nature of their relationship and the motive for the shooting remain unknown. Both suspects are juveniles, and we are limited by law on what details we can provide on them. As we included in our news release on Tuesday, the 17-year-old was under the supervision of Department of Juvenile Services and was wearing an ankle monitor for an incident in Anne Arundel County. The 14-year-old was not wearing an ankle bracelet. At this point, we do not believe the non-fatal shooting that occurred nearby later on October 12th is related to this incident. That remains under investigation, and no suspects have been identified. We are offering a reward of up to $3,000 for information on that case. I will now turn it over to Superintendent Barnes.
Thank you, Chief, and good afternoon. On Tuesday of this week, I received a notification that no superintendent wishes to receive, that the safety and well-being of members of my HCPSS family were potentially in serious jeopardy. As someone who is responsible for the safety and well-being of students and staff, and by extension, our students' families, you can imagine that I stand here in a state of extreme frustration and concern. The situation that existed at Howard High School and led to the events on Tuesday of this week are not acceptable considering the escalation of school violence in our country. I join the voices of our students, staff, families, and all those who care for the safety of our most precious resource, our children, to say that we must review every law, policy, regulation, practice, and protocol in place across the state and within our school system that impact the safety of our students in the learning process. And it is my intent to leave no stone unturned in this effort, and especially in the areas that I can control directly, which are the safety measures and protocols in our school buildings and our plan for appropriately educating students with known criminal histories. This is a time for swift and collective action that prioritizes the safety of children and staff. Simultaneously, I stand here grateful that the event that unfolded Tuesday at Howard High School resulted in no physical harm to any individual at that school. I commend Chief Durr and the officers who were on site for their swift response. I commend Howard High School Principal Stephen Fleming and his administrative team, security personnel, and each and every staff member in that building for the remarkable and professional manner in which they led in that space and tended to the needs of our students. And I also want to thank our Office of Safety and Security, members of our crisis response team, and school system leadership for being available and on site to provide support to students and staff at Howard High School. My gratitude for those staff can't be expressed strongly enough, but while I'm grateful that we're here talking about an event that resulted in no physical harm and the safe removal of a student, it feels like we were way too close to this kind of situation resulting in a very different conclusion. And it's not hard for me to imagine what that alternative outcome might have looked like, because over and over again, we bear witness to horrific scenes of school violence across the United States, in Maryland, and over the past two decades. Let me begin by addressing Tuesday's event and the release of subsequent information. We knew that we had a student from a neighboring district who was enrolling in our school system last spring and receiving support from the Department of Juvenile Services. We did not know, because no additional information was disclosed to the school system by the Department of Juvenile Services, the history or nature of the student's prior alleged crimes. We learned yesterday, following the bail hearing, of very serious alleged violent offenses in this individual's past. If this information and data had been available to me prior to yesterday, I assure our community that I would not approve a placement at Howard High School. Good decisions are predicated on accurate data, and I now know that there is important data not available to the school system that informs our placement. Now that we've identified flaws in our current systems, let me talk about how we're going to respond. I want to briefly share the work that's occurred over the first 3 months of my tenure, and then I'll share how we'll accelerate efforts based on the lessons we've learned from this week. Over the past 3 months, we have reviewed and updated our safety plans at each and every one of our schools and office buildings. We've streamlined our school emergency operation procedures to ensure a timely and efficient response in the event of an emergency. And we've provided significant training from our Office of Safety and Security to school administrators related to threat assessments, search and seizure, drug possession, and other critical topics. Additionally, we continuously review and adapt our safety protocols to reflect best practice in collaboration with the Howard County Police Department and the Maryland Center for Safe Schools. School resource officers and other security personnel in schools are trained in de-escalation techniques and follow protocols designed to prioritize the safety and well-being of students and staff. And our school system implements a comprehensive approach to safety, which includes physical security measures, staff training, emergency response planning, and student engagement to help students with ways to report possible threats and information. Most importantly, relationships are our best security measure, and we must continue to cultivate those relationships to prevent students from feeling the need to bring a weapon into a school or take threatening action. In most cases, with students who have incidents that resulted in arrest, collaboration between law enforcement and judicial agencies, the family, and the school system work well. But that was not the case in this instance. And our current efforts are frankly not enough. And we have much more work to do, and there are several steps I'm announcing today to enhance the security of our school communities. First, I want to share that over the past few days, I've received emails from community members who have experience in the field of safety and security, and I want to thank them for their offer to help, and I want to create space for that help to be received. So in order to complement our very effective internal security team that works with county agencies that is already in place, I'm convening an active external school safety and security advisory group made up of students, staff members, parents, police, county officials, and other community members so that we can begin to deeply explore our current safety measures and make recommendations for improvement to the Board of Education. I'm charging this advisory group to consider every possible possibility, and to put any and every solution on the table. I'm also accelerating their work to implement solutions as soon as possible so that we can inform our upcoming budget season. Second, I've tasked staff to undergo a comprehensive case review for the students, the 48 students who we are aware of having reportable offenses or who have been detained or committed by the Department of Juvenile Services. I need to make sure that each and every student is receives an appropriate and most appropriate educational placement, and I will make adjustments accordingly. I want to conclude my remarks by once again thanking Chief Durr and his team for an exemplary response and continued partnership. We work well together, and when instances like this occur, when crimes are committed within our county, we regularly receive updates and information and can partner to inform placement so that both we are educating students involved in these crimes and we are keeping students and staff safe. I want to thank County Executive Ball, members of the Board of Education, the County Council, and others who have been rallying in support of the safety of our students and staff in schools. We will all need to work together and spend our time identifying the gaps that exist in existing systems that limit my ability to provide education to all students well while keeping all students and staff safe. I want to repeat that if anybody sees or suspects something that is a threat to school safety, please say something to a school administrator, school resource officer, or counselor, or directly report that suspicion to the Howard County Police Department. We regularly receive notices of potential threats that are able to be mitigated before they become a real danger thanks to the work of the Howard County Police Department. And I'm grateful to our students, community members, and family members who work with us in these instances. School safety is a total team effort. Thank you.
Okay, we could take a few questions. Again, the information on this case that we could release from the police side is limited, especially because both suspects are juveniles, but we'll take any questions you may have.
So Chief, I'd like to know, what role did the 14-year-old play? Did he know the victim, and who was the trigger man?
So it's still under investigation. I can tell you that the victim and the suspects were known to each other, but we're still working on that.
Both suspects?
I'm sorry?
Both suspects?
I believe so.
You said the 14-year-old that was arrested here was not on an ankle monitor. Can you talk about his previous criminal history, if he has one?
I'm not aware of any previous criminal history. I'm not provided. We weren't provided with that information.
Can you talk about the previous criminal history the 17-year-old might have had with Howard County Police?
So with Howard County Police, he's had we know him, but I can't go into detail exactly of what it is. But he's known to us.
For Mr. Barnes, when you first found out about this incident yesterday from the bail review hearing, given the 17-year-old's previous criminal history here, what's your statement to DJS about this? Did you call Mr. Schiraldi? Have you? What are those conversations going to look like?
Well, I have not made a phone call to Mr. Schiraldi. We work closely with the Department of Juvenile Services, and they've been very consistent about what they're unable to share regarding any student that's in that we take in. And it became complicated in this case because the crime that was committed by a student in another school district and in another district. And so while it was a reportable offense, I have no evidence, but I'll give the benefit of the doubt that they followed protocol and reported to the school and all those that need to be reported to. But when the student transferred to our district, there was a gap. We had no record, and we're unable to get information from the Department of Juvenile Services. And so my frustration is recognizing there are systemic gaps that resulted in this case, thankfully, only a student possessing a loaded gun in a school and not using a loaded gun in school.
Thank
supervision or have ankle monitors, do you think it's okay to have them be sitting next to other students in the classroom?
So I think that I want us to be careful. The range of other criminal offenses is large. And the reasons that students might be wearing a monitoring device on their ankle can range from they're a student who could possibly run away, or maybe they were charged with a DUI, and each case is unique in that way. Do I think that a student who is alleged to have committed first-degree murder should be in our schools? I do not. And my placement decision would have been different and reflected that. And so that is the gap that I will doggedly work with elected officials or our community members, our police force, and the Department of Juvenile Services to try to close, because that placement decision can't be hindered. There was no other evidence that would have led us to place this child anywhere but where they were placed. Every other piece of evidence we had in our possession, including the student's behavior in our schools, reflected an appropriate placement. And of course, hindsight being 2020, that feels like a gross mishit.
Did you say that 48 students are under DJS supervision in the school district now?
They provide 48 students that receive are in that system. Some are in our schools through placements. Some are still with the Department of Juvenile Services, either being detained or committed to one of the Juvenile Services Educational Program facilities.
If you decide not to place this student because he or she is under supervision by DJS, where would that student go?
Well, we would consider virtual learning solutions. We are legally required to educate all children between the ages of 5 and 21. We have to, even students with who have criminal histories, and that's part of our responsibility we take seriously. And so we would look at some virtual learning options and or other placements. I do want to take this time to proactively talk about our alternative center. We have a school called the Homewood Center. And we have had many, many community members, and certainly reacting out of fear, I understand that, offer that we should place all students in that center. That is not an appropriate placement for all students who with criminal backgrounds. This is a facility that's focused on alternative education and special education services. And so sometimes it is an appropriate placement. Sometimes it's an appropriate placement for transition. But right now, our most restrictive educational environment, a virtual learning environment, is the one that would be, I would have utilized in this specific case.
Chief, would you talk about the second suspect, the 14-year-old? Did Howard County Police arrest this individual at Anne Arundel High School, or was that Anne Arundel County Police?
So Anne Arundel County Police took him into custody. It was under our warrant. We charged him.
And did he have a weapon on him?
To my knowledge, no.
Can you tell us where you arrested him?
I don't have that information. I just know it was in Anne Arundel County. Okay. It was in a high school.
Was it in a school?
It wasn't a school.
Okay. Can you talk about the weapon that was taken from the 17-year-old the other day? We were led to believe yesterday by the prosecutors in the case that it was a gun that was retrofitted to be like a machine gun. Can you talk about what kind of weapon it was and how much ammunition was found on the site?
It was a privately made firearm, or a ghost gun, if you will. It was manipulated to be fully automatic. And it had an extended magazine.
What about ammunition?
It had ammunition. It was loaded.
Can you tell us how much?
I don't have that information.
And I think you put this out earlier, but I'd like to ask again, what is the potential motive in all this?
So we're working on that. The only thing I can tell you right now is that the victim and the suspects, they were known to each other, but we're still working on all that. So, we're not immune from crime in Howard County here. We are a safe community, but I will tell you that crime does exist. And if you see something, say something. We were fortunate that we had an alert patrol officer, fresh out of the academy, did what we taught him to do and be, observant of his surroundings. But it is a large industrial community. It's a large parking lot. Although it is walkable to the school, you could drive by there. There's pine trees. You would never know that there was a car there. So,
Mr. Barnes, just one final question for you from me. What's your message to parents that this doesn't happen again in Howard County schools?
We're going to remain vigilant and we'll be really thinking of, including these immediate actions and responses and you know, case reviews and placement reviews. We're going to look at long-term mitigation strategies and certainly work with our neighboring districts to determine whether additional human, you know, personnel is part of a solution, or we're going to think about other detection devices, whether those are cameras or metal detectors or magnometers, or they didn't say that right, sorry. You know, or other detection devices. And so I think that we're gonna be vigilant. This is something that's been on one of the front burners. This is now on the front burner, receiving the extra heat needed to kind of move it forward. And so continue to partner with us. I'll certainly want to reach out to the Howard High School community in the coming weeks to kind of address their questions and be with them and just kind of, you know, help them understand how these kinds of things come about and what our responses will be.
One or two more if we have any.
Superintendent Barnes, I have a question. You alluded to the fact that you want to see some changes. Do you have an idea of what the perfect legislation would be for the state of Maryland in regards to juvenile services and juveniles who are detained by the police?
I don't have a recommendation for perfect legislation comprehensively. I do know that our inability to receive information regarding a student's criminal activity inhibits appropriate placement. There are many, many crimes that are committed where a placement in a comprehensive school is successful, is part of a rehabilitative process, and we have success story after success story to lean on. But there are also instances like this when the best support for a student, it doesn't mean we stick them on virtual learning and let them go, but the support, the wraparound services, the partnership with juvenile services can continue in a different placement with hopes that student might then work their way to a comprehensive school. But the part that I'm most interested in is learning how we can be better sharers of information across agencies. I think I want to achieve the level of collaboration that exists right now between the school system and the police department here in Howard County. If that were the case across all jurisdictions and across state agencies, I think we'd take a giant step forward toward creating safer spaces for our kids.
The 17 and 14-year-olds, do you know what their relationship is? Are they related? They come from the same area? Are they associated with a larger group or anything?
So I don't know about associations to a larger group. I know, and I don't believe that they're relatives. I believe that they are associates. I don't know exactly what.